We're running out of time. The world's stuck in a strange vibration. We're running out of time. Yeah. World's getting ready for a big graduation.
All right. Cutting through the matrix. Adding some sound effects here. What we're trying to do is we're trying to cut through the matrix. As they say these days, the matrix. And we are doing so. And the key to cutting through the matrix is to work at the level of consent. That is how the matrix is manipulated. That is how we are. We keep ourselves engaged with it through consent. Because actually, it's entirely consensual. We either consent to it or we do not consent to it. In other words, we either choose it or we choose something else. We can say no to it. We can say, no, I don't consent to that. I consent to something else. We cannot just be in a vacuum. We cannot say no to the matrix and not say yes to anything. That's impossible. So we do have to find out what we're going to say yes to. So it's both important, recognizing the matrix and the troubles that we don't want it, and also recognizing what we do want. You have to have both of those. So that's what these videos do. They show you how great the problem-free overlay is, and that's what we really want, and how terrible the matrix really is, and we don't want that. We don't want to withdraw our consent to be engaged with that matrix, for sure. And we hear about teachers saying, well, you just need to follow your joy, follow what you enjoy here, etc., etc. And the problem is that we can consent to something that we don't really like out of fear, out of being duped, out of being tricked, out of being deceived. And that is what happens with the matrix. It manipulates our consent. So we may have consented to something and we say, this is terrible, it's horrible. And then we feel guilty. Yeah, but we say, we consented to it. So we have to go along with it. No, we can withdraw our consent at any time. We were tricked into consenting to it, giving our consent. So the way to cut through the matrix, if we want to cut through the matrix, that get free of it is we can say yes to something else and withdraw our consent from the matrix, and so it can no longer manipulate us. It can no longer cause us problems. We can get free of it. We can experience the overlay instead of all this dance of impermanence, which can get very nasty and very dark. So, focusing in on consent is really the key. It is really the key. It is seeing the open door. The open door is the door of consent, and you control that. You decide which side of the door you go through the open door this way, or just remain where you are in the matrix, or you invite in the presence, the problem-free presence, to abide with you as you're here, because you can consent to that. You can consent to it. Right now, the matrix tells you don't consent to that. You have to burn off your karma first. Therein lies the big lie. Or you can't consent to that yet because you're still an evil, wicked person. You've done all these crimes. You've done all these terrible things, and therefore, if you brought that in, it would destroy you or annihilate you or drive you crazy. Or you're not worthy of it. You don't deserve it. All that stuff. Those are all lies. All lies. You might say that we're an expert at lying to ourselves because we want to try and change reality, and that too is another lie. Cannot be changed. Reality cannot be changed. So focus on the level of consent. And that's the most powerful teaching, the most powerful focus there is, the level of consent. And we usually don't do that. What we do is we take all these problems as real, like reality, and then we try to adjust and fix and do that. No, we consented to these problems. We consented to experience what we believe is our problems, even though they're imaginary problems, hypothetical problems. We consented to it. This is not reality. The world, the universe is not reality. It is a hypothetical scenario of all these problems and crises and challenges and struggles, etc., designed to figure out a solution to a expected problem with reality that hasn't yet occurred, and in fact will never occur. But we're consenting to put ourselves in this problem-based scenario. We're consenting. We made it up, and we're consenting to be here. We don't have to consent to it. We can withdraw our consent and say, no, it's a waste of time, because that problem in reality, this is modeling, will never take place in reality. So we can withdraw our consent, say, no more. We're not interested. No more consent. We do not consent to continue on this path. We do not consent to that. We consent to abiding in the problem presence of the problem-free self, problem-free reality. That's what we consent to now. We consent to experiencing the overlay. And that's how freedom comes. Freedom doesn't get imposed upon you. It comes from your consent. But we feel as if all these problems are being imposed upon us because we don't realize we consented to a problem-based scenario, this hypothetical scenario. We consented to it. We didn't get thrown into it. We didn't have God push us into it. Reality is consensual. The experiences we have are something we consent to. We decide. We choose. We choose. We're free in reality. We're free to choose whatever we want to choose to experience. That's the level of will, level of consent. And we gave our consent. We said we want to try and change reality. We're afraid it's going to cause problems. We consent to this hypothetical scenario that models the problems we think are going to happen, so we can work on these problems. Okay, we consented to it, but there's no need for it because reality will never have any problems at all. The problem we think is going to happen will never happen. So this is all a waste of time. It's just meaningless, really. The level of consent. Now, consent gets manipulated. When we try to withdraw our consent from this problem-based scenario, it turns into a problem. It says, well, that's a problem for you. This entire scenario of existence is a problem-based scenario. So, of course, when you decide, I want to withdraw my consent from this, this scenario says, well, that's really a problem for you. It is not a problem for us. But we're so used to dealing with problems, we can hardly see it any other way. It seems like it's a problem for us. But by focusing at the level of consent, we gradually see it's not a problem for us. It is not a problem at all. Exercising our will is not a problem for us. And yet this scenario says it is and throws up all sorts of stuff at us, saying, well, first you have to do this. First you got to get rid of your bad karma. What bad karma? Again, reality cannot be threatened in any way, cannot be harmed in any way. We are one with reality. Reality is one with all of reality. How can there be any bad karma there? On what basis? It's impossible. Nothing can be harmed. Nothing can be threatened. Nothing can be changed. Where is the basis for bad karma? None. Zero basis for it. We don't have any bad karma. But within this problem-based hypothetical scenario, we have all sorts of problems and failures and struggles and et cetera, et cetera. But that's all imaginary. It's all hypothetical. We don't have to burn off any bad karma. We don't have any. We don't have to make any reparations for anything we've done. We don't have to pay any penalties at all. There are no penalties to be paid. How could reality be demanding a penalty from us? It's only this hypothetical based scenario that's demanding penalties, reparations, payment, sacrifice, all problems from us in order to leave. So sure, you can leave, but first you have to make this payment. That's nonsense. That's nonsense. Jesus pointed that out. And allowing this whole dynamic to be exposed, he said, okay, I'm going to leave. And they said, well, you can't leave. You have to make a payment. Well, I said, what's the payment? Well, you got to be killed. Because for what? You never did anything wrong. So they said, oh, well, your death is going to pay off all the sins of the others who have to make this severe payment. We'll accept your payment or something. It just exposes the dynamic that there's supposed to be some payment made. There is not. There's no payment whatsoever that needs to be made. Because all you have to do is exercise your will, exercise your choice, exercise your consent, saying, this is where my consent is now. No payment at all. How can reality demand a payment of anyone? Cannot. Nothing can be harmed in reality. So it's only this imaginary hypothetical scenario that's problem-based, that is based on trying to deal with threat, with annihilation, which would arise if we could change reality. Reality would be annihilated. Because reality is one. You can't change a part of it and not leave the rest unchanged. That's impossible. It would completely change all of it. And since it's all one scenario, it would actually annihilate, all of reality be annihilated. But reality cannot be changed at all. So this hypothetical, we're modeling annihilation a step at a time, step at a time. We keep getting crises and threats. Death comes, and we're trying to struggle and survive here because we know our body's, you know, vulnerable to being annihilated. So we're constantly working on that. How do I stay alive? How do I survive? How do I help others survive? If I didn't help others survive, then supposedly we accumulate bad karma. We do bad things, we get bad karma. Not realizing this whole thing is consensual, even down to the individual personal level of what happens to you, actually. Theoretically, that is how it's been explained to me. It's hard to grasp that, for sure. On the micro level, it's hard to grasp that. On the macro level, it's easy. It's easy. But fortunately, the macro level is what really is important to see. Very important. We can withdraw our consent to participate in this problem-based scenario. And we can consent to experience the overlay of this scenario. When we try to do that, this scenario throws up all these problems in front of us and says, oh, before you do that, you have to do this. Not true. None of it's true. And yet it gets very devious and very tricky and very frightening. And we're afraid to, you know, meet the judge. I guess they say there's some, when you die, there's some judge, you're judged. The judge of karma, the karmic judge judges you and says, okay, you did this, it was good, and this wasn't good. That's all hypothetical. We've imagined all these karmic judges, all these laws of the universe. It's all imaginary. We ourselves, the mind in the service of spirit, in the service of the idea of what we want to be prime creator, has imagined all of this that keeps us working on these so-called hypothetical problems that we're trying to resolve, so that we have the solution in hand when reality has this problem, which it'll never have. That is the gospel. That is the good news. So when we die, you say, oh, we're judged. We're going to be final judged. Did you do good here? Did you, you know, help out? Were you good? Did you make good karma? And how much bad karma do you have? Oh, yeah, more bad karma. You got to reincarnate again and burn off the bad karma. All nonsense. Total nonsense. So really, when you reach that judge in the afterlife, or even while you're living here, what you need to do is you need to judge the judge. And you say, judge, I don't need your judgment. I only need to exercise my consent, my will, my choice. That's all. That this judge is something that I'm imagining as a device to keep me slaving away on trying to solve a hypothetical problem of threat, of annihilation. And of course, we parse out this threat gradually. Each life, we have another body, and we have to deal with all the threats to its annihilation, which are ceaseless. We also have to deal with the threat of the culture being annihilated, our civilization, the planet being annihilated, all this stuff, which these things are coming up now in history. Historically, we're at the point now where the threat to the annihilation is being presented to us in bigger ways, bigger crises. Threat of global war, threat of global totalitarianism, threat of massive viruses being released, threats of all sorts of subtle mind control techniques, threats of the planet dying as far as the ecosystems and the ozone and the atmosphere, the whole ecosystem, threats of a pole shift, threats of superwave, cosmic superwave of high energy particles melting down the earth, threats of every type of thing. We're now facing the challenge of these super threats, and we're trying to figure out a way to adapt and survive from these super threats that we're getting. Meanwhile, there are those who are saying, myself saying also, you can sidestep all of this because you can decide, hey, dealing with threats of my annihilation is meaningless because reality cannot be changed, so there is no annihilation to what I am whatsoever. So I just need to remember this. I just need to consent to remember reality. That's all. I consent to remember reality as it is, not as how we imagine it is going to be. As it is. So there's a storm is hitting the electrical here a little bit. The storm is almost passed, as a matter of fact. It was a very powerful storm. Another one came through last night and this morning, and now they said it's going to taper off about noon. It's about noon, and it is tapering off. Pretty good. High def off the radar. We can literally say, we consent to remembering reality as it is, not as how we fear it may become, as it is. Then literally we will be saved. The Passover principle is in play. And we don't have to suffer from these crises. This is gospel truth. This is what I see as fact. As you see this, this empowers you, and the notion that somebody can target you or threaten you, etc., starts to recede. And you say, no, not really. No. I don't give my consent to that. You realize you can literally withdraw your consent from the entire scenario, and then you cannot be harmed. And if the whole scenario goes into one of global crisis, you will be in a situation where you cannot be harmed. You will not be faced with threats. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead, meaning let those who want to deal with threats to their annihilation deal with those threats. You, who are called to accept reality as it is, do not have to go through those threats. You can be saved from those threats. That is a fact. This is what I'm driving home here. And this is the context we're working on, literally. Because the threats to the planet are coming. The crises, you see, in existence, the crises are amped up, as this ultimate annihilation is parsed out, so we get to work on it bit by bit. And the crises that are coming on this planet are severe. That was in the Bible, saying that the end times of this cycle will be the most severe crises the planet has ever experienced. And if it weren't for certain situations, no life would survive on the planet. It's going to be so bad. So these are crises. Now, of course, people are burrowing underground. The elites have burrowed underground already. I mean, they built these massive tunneling devices. They got some technology from the ETs also, and they've been able to make underground complexes all over the place, stock them, etc. And the ETs also dwell underground, knowing that that's a safer place. They can ride out the catastrophes underground, or they're trying to get into space stations, or some maybe go to the moon, have a station on the moon, trying to figure out some way to survive this crisis. They have seed banks that are put in the middle of granite mountains, and they feel that after the crises they can re-terraform the earth, etc. And to some extent that's accurate, because I saw the future, and I saw after the earth was melted down, as it were, and the topography changed, people came out from under the earth. They had been living inside under the ground, and I saw them coming up from underground like termites emerging. And then they started walking around the surface of the world, and then they brought their seeds, and they started planting the seeds, and they had greenhouses. They had all this stuff coming from underground too. And they started planting, and they started terraforming the world. And also, ETs from other places arrived here on spaceships on the planet after the crises. So some people are going to actually go underground. Some are going to go on spaceships and go onto motherships and spend some time there waiting for the Earth to be remodeled. That's what I saw very clearly. But there's other options as well. And I'm trying to... option of relocation is very much an option. That's the option that Jesus spoke about. What he was really saying is the rapture, coming back, you're going to go where I am, to the place that I prepared for you, is pretty literally saying he's going to manifest a place, a problem-free place, and take those who want to accept... Their consent is to accept reality as it is. They will be able to go there. They will be able to go there and completely sidestep the problems that are coming. All the nightmares here on this planet. There are so many crises and problems coming that it's just like an avalanche, being snowed under by an avalanche. Because in every facet, it seems like that we're reaching the threshold of super weird, super problematical. Becoming our survival is going to become super problematical. All by design. That's what this scenario does. It makes our survival super problematical, and then we have to keep adapting, and then it keeps bringing in even more problems. And when we think we got it made, it'll say, guess what, there's some planet somewhere there and the people are about going through some crisis. You have to go help them and get them through that. And then, and if you don't, your own survival will be threatened because this planet, and so you have to, then you will become in the future the ETs who are trying to rescue people on another planet who's under crisis. And it goes on and on and on and on, cycling that way, on and on and on. You don't get free of it ever until you withdraw your consent from this hypothetical scenario and you decide to accept reality as it is. Not as how we believe it will become through some change, because that automatically places us in this hypothetical scenario. We engage with this. We consent to it. We consent to it because we believe it's necessary. Otherwise, we'll be annihilated. But the realization is that reality can't be changed. We cannot be annihilated. We are not threatened in any way. Therefore, we do not have to engage to consent to this hypothetical scenario at all. We can consent to experiencing the problem-free nature of reality, reality as it is. Now, we need a halfway house simply because of the sense of continuity and familiarity. It's helpful to have a halfway house. So maybe there'll be a place, a planet, etc., to dwell in that's problem-free. We're not threatened with crises. And then we will spend our time allowing the acceptance of the problem-free nature of reality to abide with us. And once we do that, then very easily we have full acceptance and consent for reality to experience it as it is instead of trying to experience it as a hypothetical. That's the scope of the situation. Consent is crucial. To see it at that level of consent, that literally you can bypass, you can decide that you don't need to engage with these problems. You don't need to be threatened. Your life doesn't need to be threatened. You don't need to be in a situation of threat, of vulnerability, of scarcity, of survival problems at all, from anywhere, cosmically, the sun, the superwave from the galactic center. You don't have to be threatened by any of that. The global earthquakes, a pole shift, a crustal shift, all this magnetic shift, floods, droughts, wars, genocides, viruses, afflictions of all types, radiation, ozone problem with radiation, and manipulation of your brain, psychoactive drugs, antipsychotic, all these drugs will put you on, all these sounds being affected by low frequency sounds. They're using waves right now. They're doing all sorts of things that'll subject us to tremendous threat of survival. We don't have to be subjected to any of that at all. And it's all based on our consent. Because here's the thing, we cannot be relocated to a safe place without our consent. That's impossible. We have to give our consent to it. So it boils down to consent. And if we say, oh, wait a minute, I have all this negative karma that I've accrued and I need to burn that off before I can go there. Says who? Says the hypothetical scenario, problem-based scenario, saying that. Christ isn't saying that. The inner, our true identity, call it whatever you want, call it Krishna, Christ, Buddha nature, etc., is not saying that. Original nature, true nature, all these terms for it. It's not saying that. Because it'll say, bad karma, what's that? I've never had any bad karma. I've never had any problems. It's impossible. The notion is just ludicrous. And so all it's saying is, hey, just give your consent to experience your true self, and then you'll experience it. That's all. It's just consensual. It's consent. It is not based on karma. It is not based on some cosmic configurations, cosmic alignments. We don't have to wait for a cosmic alignment. It's 100% based on consent, which we have within us, which is our will, which is our spirit. And again, we're deluded into, from our desire to be prime creator, we then, this enormous fear arose that, we have to change reality. And then we said, that means actually the annihilation of reality. So, how are we going to deal with that? And then we consented to work on this problem in a hypothetical scenario projected into some imaginary place we call the future or time. And we consented to it out of drastic fear, not getting kind of confused, not forgetting that all we had to do was drop this idea of wanting to be prime creator and choose the idea of not wanting to be prime creator. Boom, no more fear like that. Instead, we consented to work on this problem, work on the problem of annihilation. We don't have to. There is no annihilation. There is no problem of annihilation. Reality can't be changed at all. We don't have the will. There is no such power to change reality. Never will be. So the level, the hypothetical scenario targets consent. It targets it. It knows it's vulnerable to consent. It knows it. It doesn't understand it, what consent really is. It just knows it's threatened. There's just some kind of threat, and it's terrified of this threat. Like saying, "Oh my gosh, I'm going to be annihilated if I don't keep everyone working on this problem of annihilation. Annihilation is going to happen." No, we are simply modeling it. The mind is modeling annihilation, symbolizing it. There isn't any actual annihilation going to happen at all if we stop working on trying to solve the problem of annihilation. That is just symbolic. But this dream, this hypothetical scenario, feels threatened if we stop working on it. So it tells us, you must keep working, and keeps manipulating your consent, saying, you got to do it, otherwise you'll be annihilated. So we give our consent. Or you'll never have love if you don't do this. Or you have been wicked and you have to pay the price by working on it. Or you've been lazy. All these different ways. It's super clever in manipulating our consent. And I've spoken about some of the ways that it does this. And it's useful, very helpful to see. Like, so that's how my consent's been manipulated. I've been told that I need to have loving relationships with quote-unquote people. I mean, workers in this dream of trying to overcome a threat of annihilation. I'm supposed to have loving relationships here. If I don't, how can I possibly believe that I'm capable of experiencing love or experiencing the problem-free condition of the self? And so you're supposed to then, and of course, then what happens? You get in a loving relationship. What happens here? Everything is geared towards working on threat, working on annihilation, working on survival, and you're supposed to help the survival of the loved one. If you don't, then you're bad. You're bad. It's nuts. We're supposed to be working here on freeing ourselves from this delusion, being aware of the level of consent, and recognizing that reality can never be changed. Therefore, this whole thing is totally unnecessary. All of it. There's not a shred of it that's necessary. Nothing in the universe is necessary whatsoever, not a shred of it. Of course, I'm speaking of the universe of time, space, and impermanence, which is all symbolic. Now, there is a creation of essence and idea that some people call a universe or et cetera, oneness creation, but we're not perceiving that. We're not aware of it. We're not perceiving that. The universe we perceive is totally hypothetical, totally unnecessary. It's all based on threat. All based on threat. All based on vulnerability and trying to develop in so-called intelligent survivability. Trying to become survivalists. We're survivalists here. The whole thing is to keep learning how to survive greater and greater threats. It gets tired after a while. It gets old. You say, there must be something better for us here than just constantly faced with threats to our survival. There is. Drop your consent from this scenario and consent to experience reality as it is. That's what's better. Way better. So whatever interferes with our consent, which in other words, which is tricking us into continuing to give our consent to working on this hypothetical scenario, that is problematical for us, not for our identity, but it is problematic in terms of us remaining engaged with all these crises, with all these problems. It's problematic in that we keep consenting to all these problems. So it's super important to be aware of how the manipulations that are going on to get our consent, the carrot and the stick, so to speak. We say, well, if you keep working on problems, we're going to give you a lot of gifts. And if you don't keep working on it, we're going to punish you severely. We're going to ban you from this hypothetical scenario. You're going to be banned. That's how this scenario spins it. When you withdraw your consent, it doesn't recognize that. What it does is it tells you that you didn't withdraw your consent, that this hypothetical scenario banned you from existence, and you are now excluded. You'll never work in this town again, is what it says to you. Because it refuses, it cannot recognize the level of consent, because it's a denial of that level of consent. It's a denial of it. So it will say, when you withdraw your consent, it will say that it has banned you But that's not true. That's not true. You simply withdrew your consent. And so we feel threatened, like, oh my gosh, I'll be banned from existence. I'll never be able to come here again. Well, we don't need to come here. Nobody needs to come here. So that's no problem whatsoever. And you can come here, you can give your consent to come here as a clarifier, as a teacher, as an ambassador of certitude, and this scenario cannot stop that, prevent that at all. So it is not true that you can be banned from existence. You can be excluded. It also says you're going to be excluded from the new creation, because once we realize and figure out how to survive in total annihilation of reality, we will then create a new kingdom, and you will be excluded from that new kingdom. So you're trying to separate from your brothers and sisters here. That they'll tell you that, exactly tell you that. It will say, you are attempting to separate from your brothers and sisters, and you will live in eternal damnation and guilt if you do that. So don't dare do that. Remain engaged with this scenario. And then another total lie. Because brothers and sisters in spirit, one sonship, one reality, you're engaged with all of reality. Everyone is, perfectly, seamlessly, always and forever. It's impossible to be separate from anyone. So that's a ludicrous thing for the scenario to say. Because there never will be a new creation, a new kingdom, because this threat of annihilation is symbolic. It's hypothetical. There is no threat of annihilation. You're not learning to come overcome annihilation. You're learning to try and overcome a symbolic annihilation. And everything you do here is symbolic anyway. And there's no annihilation of reality whatsoever. So you're not separating from anyone. You are not separating from anyone. That's a total lie. But that lie will be brought up. I've been faced with that one, most definitely. It was bad at the time. It was terrifying. I said, oh my gosh, I'm choosing to separate from everyone. Oh my gosh, how terrible. I'm terrible. How can I prevent that? No, another one of its lies. And it's got a whole quiver of them. It keeps shooting them at you. You say, here's one, here's another, here's another, here's another, here's another. And so you spend your time on the spiritual path vetting these lies, essentially, and say, wait a minute, that's a lie. I don't believe that. And it's not easy, because these things frighten you. They're meant to frighten you. They're meant to frighten you, so you back away from the level of consent. You feel as if you don't dare get to the level of consent because you're afraid you might use the consent and decide, no, I'm finished with this. You're terrified of it, so you refuse to acknowledge the level of consent within you. You refuse to acknowledge it. You're afraid of it. It's meant to terrify you of it, in fear that you might use it and decide, I don't want any more of this, and then you'll be separate from everyone forever. You'll be banned from the new kingdom. You'll be excluded, and you'll be annihilated. That's what you're told. All of it is a lie. And I couldn't be saying these things here if I was terrified of it, because my voice would dry up out of fear. But I've already worked through most of this stuff, so I can say these things. And some people might say, "What is he talking about? I've never heard this stuff. It's nuts." And if it hasn't been said, because most people haven't worked through these intimidations, threats, and fears that cause you to withdraw from your awareness from the level of consent out of fear you might use it, and so they don't go in that depth. They stay away from the level of consent. Once you look at the level of consent, then you start seeing how it all works, how this hypothetical scenario actually works to intimidate you and bully you into not using consent, your consent, not exercising it. And so, but if you lose this fear, you can talk about this. You can showcase it, highlight it, emphasize it. And of course, people are gonna scratch their heads and say, "Huh, what is this? You know, there's something there, but I'm not really sure what." That's normal. That's a normal reaction, because it doesn't get spoken of here very often. Very often, it's not easy. It's taken me a long time, way longer than I thought. I thought I'd be able to speak about this decades ago. I could not. It was too difficult. I was too frightened, because I kept getting hit by these threats. If you do this, this is what's going to happen to you. And of course, I thought it might. And so it's so threatening. I just was saturated in dread and fear. And I had to keep gradually examining whether this threat was credible or not. And I gradually saw it's not credible at all. These threats are not credible. they're delusional. And so I've gradually lost most of the fear to say this. I still have some. So when I put out these videos afterwards, I say, oh my gosh, what did I do? Now I'm really in for it. Now I'm really going to be excluded. This is, and I feel really tired sometimes, super tired. It's like, collapse. I said, wow, that was a great effort to say this stuff in the face of all these so-called reprisals and threats, etc., what's supposedly going to happen to me in the future for even talking about this utter taboo. This level is utterly taboo in the universe, totally taboo. You cannot, you're not supposed to talk about this stuff at all. Completely taboo. And I came here in this world to break those taboos, absolutely. But it's been a long effort to do so. Long effort. But here it is, we're doing it. And of course, by listening, you're breaking the taboos too. And you're starting to get a sense like, wait a minute, maybe I'm not stuck in the matrix at all. It's just that I haven't been willing to exercise my consent because I believed it was going to exclude me and I'd be completely excluded from and annihilated if I was aware of my power of consent. The power of consent. It's the navigation. It's your steering mechanism. You can decide to steer into this idea or steer into this idea. But if you don't, if you think that you're not doing the steering, that the effects are doing the steering, you feel like you got no chance. You got no chance. You're at the mercy of the matrix, and then you just try to fight against it. You don't need to fight against it. You just need to withdraw your consent from it. Totally different. Totally different. You don't need to be a warrior of light. You simply need to withdraw your consent. Woo. Wow, I almost passed out there. Wow. My brain went woo, 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 almost passed out. Got lightheaded suddenly. Lightheaded. System is tingling. Lightheadedness. Okay. Fine. It's passing. So talking about these taboos, listening to them, you get the sense, hey, wait a minute. Maybe I don't need to be a warrior light. Maybe I don't need to be an avenging angel. Maybe I don't need to be part of the battle in the heavens. All this stuff. Of course you don't. Of course you don't. Absolutely do not. That is all part of the delusion. Which is, why would you be fighting like this unless you thought you were threatened? If you're not threatened at all, what do you have to fight about? If reality isn't threatened, what do you have to fight about? Nothing. It's all consent-based. If you're aware that it's consent-based, you then realize you don't have to engage in some titanic cosmic conflict. You don't have to engage in any conflict at all. You don't have to engage in any fight. You're not threatened. You're not going to be separated from reality. You're not going to be separated from, you're not going to be excluded from some new kingdom. You don't have to fight for your right to be included in some new kingdom. None of that. You don't have to defeat the darkness or the wickedness, etc. You don't have to triumph. You simply withdraw your consent. That's not a triumph. Not triumphing over anything. I don't want to triumph over existence. I don't feel that at all. I have affection for existence because it's the imagination of spirit, mind presented this. So of course I have affection for everyone here and everything here. I used to have too much affection for it and too much compassion and affection. Say, oh, we made this, so you know, this is our home, this is our baby, this is our baby. So of course I have affection for it. But I understand it's all symbolic, it's all hypothetical, and I can withdraw my consent from engaging with this hypothetical. But in doing so, I choose the overlay of it, which blesses all of it. So it blesses our baby. Our baby's being blessed. Our imagination is being blessed. What our imagination has imagined is being blessed. That's what I want to do. Now, of course, I can love the world or feel affection. It's not real love because it's impermanent. You can't love impermanence, but affection, of course. You really cannot love impermanence. You can't love a hypothetical, but you can have what's called affection for it. which is, it's not really love, true love at all. It's affection. But again, it's imaginary love is what it is, which we better determine affection than love, because our what we're experiencing here is imaginary. It's hypothetical. So love is not hypothetical. It's not imaginary. So when we have this imaginary scenario, it's affection. We call it, to differentiate, it's affection. We have affection for all of this. And I imagine there might be some place in the planet that I can truly love. I just haven't found it yet. And watching these videos, a documentary series, one is called Long Way Around, the other is called Long Way Down by BBC. They're on YouTube. And one is about 10 hours long, one's about 6 hours long in segments, 1 hour segments. And this one of them takes you through the continent of what used to be Soviet Union, Kazakhstan, and then into Mongolia, and then through Mongolia, and through into Siberia, through Siberia. And the other takes you down through Africa, into Tunisia, through Libya, Egypt, then down through Egypt to Sudan, Ethiopia, Rwanda, Botswana, then down to Tanzania, then over to Tanzania, Botswana, Namibia, South Africa. It takes you through these continents on motorcycles, and you see the land, the landscape, how it is there. And I say, my God, I've always wanted to see this. And I was so struck by it, and I said, holy cow. The planet's the same all over the whole world. It's all the same. It's all the same. I was hoping maybe there's some place that's not the same, but it's all the same. Not even in Siberia is it. It's the same. Gosh, I looked at the dirt, the rocks, the dust, the rivers, the floods, the trees, the grass, the weeds, the mountains, everything is the same, the whole planet over. Like, wow. Amazing. And that helped a lot, just to free me, detach from it. Say, oh my gosh, there's no special place on this planet, really. There's really not. It's all vulnerability. It's all threat. The whole planet is this problem-based scenario, the threat-based scenario. There's nobody anywhere that is living in some paradise that's free of threat. I mean, there was this guru who has this whole, bought an island in Fiji and had this, his own island, and all the devotees went to this island, and they're trying to build a paradise there. You know, it's a sacred sanctuary and ashram and everything there. And a couple years ago, there was a horrific typhoon ripping through there, just devastating, just devastated the place, devastated it. So were they really free of threat there? Not at all. Threats to their survival, the food, everything. Typhoon can come along and they're isolated, could wiped out, you know, just horrific. Ripping up trees, ripping up their food sources, flooding their lands, ripping their dwelling places. Just so, you know, you cannot build a utopia here on this planet. Even underground, you're going to have lots of threats to your survival. There's no place in Siberia, there's no place in Africa that you can hang out. I was thinking, like, maybe in Africa there's someplace, and some, you know, because it's just the bush out there. I looked at the bush and I said, gosh, that's not very beautiful. Lousy. You can see that the swamps are there, the mud is there, the struggles for survival is there. Everything is like, oh God, there's this. No, that's not it. I come from a family of those who are searching for it. Ancestors, my ancestors, Commodore, I had ancestors that searched for it, and for some place in the world that was it. And so it's natural to me to do a global search, but in using YouTube to do it, you save a lot of time, and you just notice. If you notice, oh my gosh, it's not in Bangladesh. I searched all through, not in Nagaland. It's not in Burma. It's not any of these. It's not in the Himalayas. It's not here. It's not in Tibet. It's not in Mongolia. It's not in Siberia. It's not in the Antarctic. You start to realize it's not anywhere here. It is not anywhere here. And you say, oh boy, this whole thing is a problem-based scenario. It's all a problem-based scenario. The entirety of it is a problem-based scenario. And that's what it is. It is what it is. It literally is what it is. And you recognize what it is. You say, I can't change it, but I can withdraw my consent from it to experience it. You can't change effects of an idea, but you can withdraw your consent from the idea. Consent is at the level of ideas. You can withdraw your consent from the idea, saying, no, I want to experience something different. And then you can say, I want to experience reality as it is, instead of how hypothetically it's going to become. Because becoming, the notion of reality becoming, is actually annihilation. We need to see that. We need to see reality as one. All the laws, the way reality functions, is true for the entirety of reality. And there's not a single exception anywhere. There is absolutely no exception in reality. No exception. None. So if anything, even the tiniest speck of reality, was made an exception for, it would annihilate all of reality. And one of the great, great helps that we were given in this hypothetical scenario of problems was A Course in Miracles, because it pointed out and clarified about reality cannot be changed in any way, or it annihilate all of it. And that sunk in for me. It sunk in, and I saw it. I said, wow, that is true. I see what is being said. Reality is all one. There's not parts of reality. It's not fragmented. It's seamless, completely seamless. And totally problem-free. Can never be threatened or harmed in any way. And I've actually experienced that. And then A Course in Miracles backed up my experiencing, and I had faith in my experience. It was true. It backed it up and said, here's the conceptual framework to look at and see that what you experienced was true. That is reality. Cannot be harmed in any way. Cannot be changed, corrupted, undermined, threatened in any way. And if it were, it would all be completely annihilated. So, there you have it. To see that is to recognize that we cannot, this parsing out of problems is a waste of time. It's a waste of time. Reality cannot be harmed in any way. So becoming, this whole becoming thing, is nonsense. Reality can't become anything. It is what it is and will always be what it is. There's no time involved. And becoming means time. It will become something else. There is no such thing as time in reality. It's the eternal now. Eternal nowness, meaning it's always this way. It's always the way it is right now. That's what this now, the way it is right now, it'll always be that way. That's the eternal nowness of reality. It's not going to change. It's not going to become something different. It will expand and enrich itself, ceaselessly being enriched, 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 enriched. But it's not going to become something different than what it is, and always is, and always will be. So we're working on becoming? No. Now we're working on annihilation, let's be honest. We are working on this hypothetical scenario, we are working on annihilation. And we're working at it bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. Bit by bit, life after life after life, planet after planet, scenario after scenario. Always where we find ourselves is, okay, where's the challenge? Where's the threat? And we say, oh, okay, there it is. But I was taken in spirit to a planet, a dwelling place, where there was no problems whatsoever. And I was able to see that no threat had ever happened there. No harm had ever happened. And the planet seemed like, from the beginning of time, it was timeless, like it had been there for billions of years, as it were. And I didn't notice the slightest sign of threat or harm to anything there. Never had happened. In other words, it wasn't based on this hypothetical scenario of annihilation. It was not. It was based on consent to accept reality as it is. It was based on that consent, that idea, and a planet arose, and maybe many planets, a whole universe could arise from that, and we can literally dwell there. I saw that I was welcome there, and I can dwell there, and I had a sense of a body there too. I had a sense of having a body there, and I can dwell there, and I felt naturally just simply, I felt this automatic meditation, contemplation there of gratitude and great affection, and great affection, even getting close to love there for this problem-free condition. No threat of annihilation whatsoever. I felt this, nothing here is threatened. Nothing here will ever be threatened. I said, yes, that is what I want to experience and accept. And I was started to feel this, this sense of what you would probably call love, which is different than affection, different than what we experience here. We don't really experience love here. We do not. There are some great gurus, great saviors come in the world who are experiencing love, and but it's universal. They say there's nothing. It's all equal love for everything, always complete overlay. But we don't really experience love here. But in this other realm, this death-free, problem-free realm, I was starting to expand. Affection was expanding into something greater than affection, which had encompassed everything. At first I saw a tree, and then another tree, and then a lake, and then a lagoon, and then I was seeing pathways, and I was seeing, started to see more and more, and my affection was expanding more and more and more, and I was starting to expand and cover everything that I was, everything here. It was like limitless, starting to go in that direction. That is moving toward acceptance of reality as it is. And we have that option. We always have that option. It can even be done on this planet. And some have done it here. But the crises that we are facing now at the end of this cycle are planetary in scope. And it may be very difficult just to survive here at all. So doing it here on this planet may become very problematical, very difficult, and not really feasible. That is a possibility. We need to at least be aware that's a possibility. And maybe relocation will be a necessity. Maybe. I'm not putting this in stone, but I'm saying, from my standpoint, it's a likelihood. A strong likelihood. I'm putting it that, a strong likelihood. But I'm still functioning here as if we need to get this right here on this planet, this world. We need to choose the overlay, consent to the overlay, and experience it right here where we are. I'm still going on that premise. But I still also have a strong likelihood that there will be relocation at some point. I don't know at what point. I don't have a time frame on it right at this point, right now. But when you see it at the level of consent, then relocation doesn't become a problem at all. I'm not scared about it at all. Actually, I'd welcome it. I don't see it as problematical, because this relocation doesn't come from this hypothetical scenario. It comes from accepting reality as it is, which is no problems at all. So it is not problematical. There, remember, in this hypothetical scenario, everything is supposed to be problematical. It's all problematical. So when we say relocation, we say, oh my gosh, that will be super problematical. How are we going to do that? But from the standpoint of accepting reality as it is, there's no problems. So it wouldn't be problematical at all. Would not be problematical for us. And we have a hard time accepting that because we're so familiar with problems. We don't see how anything could not be problematical. We simply, how is that possible? It's not problematical. But I assure you, would not be problematical. There would be a completely problem-free way to do it. Completely problem-free. Piece of cake. No threat, no problem. We'd have affection for the way. We just feel this great affection, like, this is so wonderful. Thank you so much. I've been given previews of this other realm. I was through a certain situation, an offer that arose, I was able to go out on this very private golf course that is membership only and is not used very much. I was like almost, I think I was about the only one out there on the golf course, actually. Yeah, very few people are out there. And it was incredibly beautiful. And I got this sense of awe and affection. My affection became so extreme for the whole area. I just had this immense affection for it because it was so peaceful and it felt so non-threatening. The area was so non-threatening to me. And I just stopped and I just I just looked around and said, I want to stay here forever. I don't even want to move. I'll just sit in the golf cart here forever because it's so beautiful and peaceful. There wasn't a sound. It was just soft and lush. It wasn't like Mongolia that it seemed harsh. No, it was lush, beautiful and lush and sparkling lakes. And it's just like no people, no roads, no sign of civilization, yet it was all lush and manicured and beautiful. It's like, wow. I just sat in the shade. I didn't want to move. And just let this affection grow. So that was a precursor to the problem-free world. It was a precursor to it. And I want to go back there, actually. I don't have the means have not arisen to do that because maybe my consciousness is still in the problem-based scenario. Maybe if I accept to the path of accepting reality as it is, there will be a way to go back there. And I'd like to film from there. I'd like to host these satsangs from there. I really would. Because that really is like a half, sort of a halfway house to the problem-free realm. Is you start to experience your affection expanding and to encompass everything. I mean, it was encompassing the rocks, the stones, the dust, the dirt, the atmosphere, the trees, the leaves, the grass, the sand. Everything, it was just everything was included in that affection. It wasn't affection to some person. The problem with affection towards people is it tends to exclude everyone else. It's a special relationship, but Jesus is so adamant about how that is ruinous to us. A Course in Miracles is so adamant about saying the special relationship is ruinous, don't. And I kind of said, well, what in the world is it talking about? I mean, there's nothing wrong with having affection for someone. But what he's getting at is that what you're trying to do is you're trying to have to minimize your affection, which is cutting off love. What you need to do, affection has to expand to include everything without exception. And at that point, it then can be translated into love, true love. So that's what he's saying, that don't try to channel all your affection into a person. It's better, what is better is to be in a place, a situation where you feel affection expanding to encompass everything without exception. You're not feeling like you're judging where is your affection going at all. Now, when you're around people, we automatically become very judgmental. Like, I like this person more, I like this person, I feel a little threatened, or I'm attracted to this person, or I don't want to be attracted to that person. This feels like a trap, or here's a very attractive person, but it feels like an entrapment type of thing. Or this person, well, they're okay, and how do I get along with them? And it's just like, woo, 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 and your affection is all fragmented. When you're in a beautiful spot of nature, where there's nobody around, really, then your affection can spread out. That's what I felt. I went out at 5:30 in the morning, on this one golf course, and this tropical like storm had come in and saturated the whole place, and there was this incredible dawning, and the rain was still, those little sprinkles are just, and it was lush, and if the moisture was there, and the incredible dawn hitting the clouds, and I was the first person out. There's nobody out in front of me anywhere on the whole golf course. I was by myself. And it was one of the best golf courses in the world. It was just like, it was blowing my mind. My affection, I had to stop and my affection spread out. This was another golf course. This was actually a public golf course. My affection spread out to encompass the whole golf course, the whole area, and was just spreading out. And I said, I have affection for everything. And the whole notion of judgment disappeared. It means I was getting close to actual love. The thought of not having affection didn't even occur to me. It was like my breath almost stopped. I wasn't even aware of my breath. I wasn't even aware of my body. Not really. And of course, I couldn't play golf at that point. I had to stop playing golf. I couldn't hit the shot because my body was still. My whole body became still. And movement stopped. I didn't even want to move. I just wanted to feel this affection. I had this enormous affection, like, thank you for this beauty. Thank you for this beauty. It's just too stupendous. So I had this enormous gratitude and affection, saying, thank you for putting me here. I'm so grateful for you putting me here. But it wasn't a harmful thing. I didn't pass out. I didn't go crazy. I didn't throw off my clothes and go jump in the lake or something. No. I still had a sense of propriety and everything. I didn't feel like I needed to go into a drum circle and go get in some static mode. No. Still, I felt still. Peaceful, calm, still. Gratitude, thanks, affection, spreading out. So those situations were, I put myself in those situations intentionally, and I consented to it, so I could get ready for this problem-free realm, which is a likelihood of relocating to that realm, actually, where you will feel this affection and a gratitude and thanks, saying, thank you for putting me here. I'm so grateful. It's just so beautiful, thank you. So places of beauty do have their use here. They do have their use. If you can get into a feeling like you're not threatened by anything, and it's so beautiful, and the affection will spread out, and you'll generalize the affection, and you won't be judging of where to put the affection. Who gets more, who gets less? No. The thought did not arise. I didn't say, that golf hole over there is difficult, and that doesn't get my, this one's nicer, this one's more beautiful, that lake there, whatever. No, it was a blanket thing. It was an overlay. It was an overlay of affection. I wasn't judging what has more and what has less. So it was really like a mini overlay at that time. I experienced it. I like to go back. So I'm sure if I give my consent to it, the means will arise that I'll be able to go to such a place. And so when I say, right now I'm saying, well, I don't have the means, it's impossible. That has to come from lack of consent. In other words, it's a problem. It's super problematical to get there right now. Super problematical. And yet, if I consent to experience reality as it is, I would expect that the problems miraculously will vanish, and I'll be able to do that. The benefit is the satsangs will become more profound. And you would get a more profound sense of this. You'll be able to see what I'm talking about. And at some point, maybe even some of you could actually come there and experience it for yourself too. There might be, that might open up too. I don't know. I don't know what will open up by agreeing, consenting to experience reality as it is. I don't know what's going to open up. But I want to find out. I want to find out. When I went down there, I said, wow. I have to hold satsang here. Have to hold it here. This is just affection. It just arises naturally. Just holy smokes, it's beautiful. And like I said, the affection can become so strong that for me, I don't even have to play golf. Don't even feel like I need to play golf. Wow, I can just sit here quietly. It's just feel like just sitting quietly without doing anything. There's a feel, you don't feel like you need to do anything. Just sit quietly. Which is how I feel when I'm doing these videos. I just feel like all I have to do is sit here quietly. I don't have to do anything. Which is a great feeling. So, this video has established an outline, at least, of the whole consent situation. And how consent can work for you. Powerfully work for you, and what it may even give for you, which is really a incredibly beautiful dwelling place that is not threatened, and that allows your affection to spread out, which is then easily translatable into this overlay of perfect love, which then is super easily translatable back into experiencing reality as it is, without any desire to experience a hypothetical at all, any becoming. That pathway is wide open. I've established a context for that pathway. Also, explaining that this scenario, hypothetical scenario, is problem-based, and those who continue to give their consent to that are very likely to experience severe crises coming up at this time. It is trending that way very strongly, very strong likelihood of that. So this whole context, you can get the context. And you can start saying, wait a minute, what am I going to give my consent to? Which way am I going to go? And hopefully you will keep watching these videos and they'll get better and better, or you can watch others from that also help you. Whatever you choose to do is fine with me. It's your consent that is the question. And hopefully I'll be relocated somewhere where it's even better than where I am right now, which is a pretty nice place, I'll tell you that. But there are still a lot of responsibilities, a lot of problems. My life is still very problematical, actually. So it would be better to get out of that into a less problematical situation where the affection can truly spread out and convey that via YouTube, these videos, convey it so you can keep getting a sense of it, keep getting a sense of it. And that helps your motivation, helps your motivation a lot. All right. So we'll end this one. I'll click over. Let me see. I'll click over to this song. Is this song still going? I'm sure it's still going. This is a song that I composed and performed, recorded, about the fact we're running out of time, because we are. In other words, when I say we're running out of time, meaning the time of crises, more severe crises, is upon us. It's coming as very close now, where the threats to our survival will become amplified, very amplified. And we need a heavenly infusion. We need some way to sidestep this. So I wrote this song back in, 1998 or something like that, knowing that we're headed to this time, because I was shown in advance what's going to happen here. Let's see at what stage this song is at, because it's just looping right now.
Everybody on your mark, yeah. Everybody get real set, yeah. Do you have the right information? We're getting ready for a new situation. We're running out of time. Climate change is causing a sensation. We're running out of time. Yeah, yeah. Strange new laws are sweeping the nation. Do you know just what they are doing? Do you know just who they are fooling? It won't be long now till they close the deal and throw away the key. How does that make you feel?
Consent is the key, and it can't be thrown away.
Come on. Now's the time for you to get it right.
That is true. This was recorded in my bedroom.
We're running out of time. Don't bother me with secular solutions. We're running out of time. Yeah, yeah. The whole world is a ball of confusion. We're running out of time. What we need is a heavenly infusion.
See?
We're running out of time.
Very true.
We gotta get free of illusion, cause we're running out of time.
We gotta get free of illusion. Of this hypothetical. Withdraw our consent from it.
We're running out of time. We're running out of time.
We're running out of time.
We're running out of time.
There you go. Running out of time.